Good morning.
As I promised, now I want to discuss the invariant measures on the homogeneity classes, and especially equilibrium measures, equilibrium states. So I will first start with the statements. And come back on things I have said in the first lecture. So there are a special class of measure that we are interested in. So the first one are measure maximizing the entropy. So remember that we have the variational principle, which says that the topological entropy of a map is the supremum of the entropy of its invariant measure. And so you say a measure maximizes the entropy if it realizes a supremum for a general system. It does not exist always. And a motivation for that in our setting, so for smooth diffeomorphism on surface, has been given recently by David Burguet. So these measures explain how periodic orbit distributes. For that, you need to consider periodic orbits that are enough hyperbolic, so whose Lyapunov exponent are bounded away from zero. If you look to all these periodic orbits and look to those whose period is bounded by n, when n goes to infinity, it converges towards some maximizing measure. So this is in dimension two. But in general, when you have CR map or where you in higher dimension, you may wonder, so if these measures always exist. So it's well known that it's a case when you have enough expansivity. So in particular for hyperbolic diffeomorphism, I have discussed at the beginning. But in general, when you only CR, it may not exist. There are counterexamples given by Jérôme Buzy. Surface. So there is a well-known important result by Newhouse in any dimension that says that if you're C infinity, in fact, for diffeomorphism on a compact manifold, it always exists. So I will come back on that later. This is for the existence. And then you may wonder about the finiteness. So finiteness among those that are ergodic. Again, it's true for hyperbolic diffeomorphisms. It has been shown in for particular cases. For instance, for non-uniformly hyperbolic maps inside the Henon family by Pierre Berger. And here I want to state a general result. So assume your C infinity again, and that the topological entropy is positive, because if it's zero, it's completely different world, in fact. Then the number of maximizing measures that are ergodic is finite. And you can show it's equal to one in the case the dynamics is transitive. So again, if the map is a CR, it may fail if the topological entropy is smaller than always this bound that I have introduced before, so log of the Lipschitz constant of F divided by R. Whereas if it's above, the same proof as this result tells you that you get a similar result. So these are for the maximizing measures, but you may look at other natural measures that have been discussed a lot by Stefano, for instance. There are the physical measures. Well, I don't recall the definition of physical measure, but in fact, when you consider physical measures that are hyperbolic, you will get a geometrical information, and so you fall inside a class of measure that is called SRB for Sinai-Ruelle-Bowen. The definition of an SRB measure. Let's talk only about hyperbolic measures. that are measures, so since it's hyperbolic, almost every point has unstable manifold, and you may disintegrate the measure along the unstable manifold. And SRB means that the disintegration are absolutely continuous. There are other characterizations. One which is related to the fact that you're physical is a stronger notion of physicality. So it says that not only you require that you have a basin with positive Lebesgue measure, so points whose orbits converge to that measure, but you also require that the Lyapunov exponent for these points exist and converge to the exponent of the measure. So if you have such a measure, it has to be SRB. And conversely, an SRB measure is physical. And another characterization where entropy appears is the second one here. So a measure is SRB if its entropy is equal to the sum of the positive Lyapunov exponents. And that, this is very useful because you can restate it in the following way. So you introduce a potential on the manifold that we call geometrical potential, so just a function, measurable function, defined in that way. So at any point where you have an unstable direction, you take minus log of the norm of of the Jacobian along the of DF along EU, and if there is no unstable space because the point is not typical for any measure, or you don't have an unstable space for the measure you would consider, then you put just minus infinity. And then you may restate condition two, saying that a measure is SRB if and only if this quantity here, so the entropy plus the integral of phi, vanishes. In fact, there is an inequality due to Ruel, which says that for any measure, this quantity is non-positive. So an SRB measure always maximizes this quantity. And if there exists a SRB measure, the maximum is zero. So in this case, the SRB measure are exactly the measure that maximizes this quantity. So you may combine both measure maximizing the entropy and SRB measure in the same setting. Which is a setting of equilibrium measure I will introduce after. Okay, I wanted to say it first, sorry. The result about SRB measures. So so about the existence, so that's a big question. That's what Stefano discusses. So what about the uniqueness or the finiteness? Well, so Hannah yesterday mentioned her result with Federico Rodriguez-Hertz, Ali Tazibi, and Raoul Ures. So for C2 diffeomorphism on surface, they prove that each homoclinic class can support at most one SRB measure. So the result is really in the spirit of what I've done before, but in the case of SRB measure, you because you're absolutely continuous along the unstable foliation, you have more geometrical structure, and you may use different arguments. You may use Hopf argument, and this is what they did. And as she said, they also have a similar notion of homoclinic classes adapted to measures. So in particular, if you consider a transitive attractor, you can meet only one non-trivial homoclinic class, and so there is at most one SRB measure on the attractor. Okay, so this is if you restrict to one class or one attractor. And then, if you look to the diffeomorphism globally, you may also get a finiteness result. So assume that for some reason you know that Lebesgue almost every point in the manifold has upper Lyapunov exponent bounded away from zero, larger than some constant delta. Then, in fact, they can exist at most finitely many ergodic SRB measures on your system. And here we need C infinity or some bound on delta. So they are for the result about SRB measure. And as I said, now we have common setting for these two class of measures, which are the equilibrium measures. So it is defined once you give a measurable map on the manifold or on the class if you restrict to a multi-class. So consider a measurable function, you call it potential, and you say that a measure is an equilibrium state for that potential if it achieves a supremum of the pressure of that potential, that is a supremum of the over the measures of the sum of the entropy plus the integral of the potential. Okay. Well, in what we do, what we use essentially is a hyperbolicity of the measure. So it's important to have a criterion to check this hyperbolicity. So as we said, on surface, measures with positive entropy are hyperbolic. And more generally, if you have an equilibrium state on surface, and if the potential satisfies a small potential condition, the fact that it's small with respect to the entropy, so this inequality here, will guarantee that the measure is hyperbolic. Again, this is due to real inequality. Okay. Any question so far? So this was about the result. And now I'd like to discuss the proof. So I will first discuss about the uniqueness or about the finiteness of the measures. So the main result is this one. We discuss the uniqueness of equilibrium measures over homoclinic classes. Then, so for instance, if you consider maximizing measure on surface for an C infinity diffeomorphism, we know that the entropy can be large only on a finite number of homoclinic classes, and so you are reduced to consider maximizing measure on each homoclinic class, and you may apply this theorem to conclude the finiteness for your system. So what is the result? So this time you fix a homoclinic class associated to a hyperbolic periodic orbit O. You consider a potential, and you need an assumption on the potentials. You need that either it's Hölder continuous or it is only measurable, but it is a geometrical potential I've introduced before. And under this condition, then there can exist at most one equilibrium state, which is hyperbolic and homoclinically related to the hyperbolic periodic orbit O. And you have more information. The support coincides with the whole class. And you can describe what the measure is, what kind of measurable dynamics you find. So in the sample, so remember the class has a period. So if the period is one, the measure is a Bernoulli measure. If the period is k, in fact, the measure is the product of a Bernoulli measure with the rotation, the permutation over k, the set with k elements. So this is what I want to discuss now. But so in fact, there are many results about uniqueness of equilibrium measures in various settings using hyperbolicity properties with different approaches. So let me mention two. You have some uses specifications, so kind of shadowing. So this appears, for instance, in the recent works by Klimenaga, Thompson, Burns, Fisher. They studied geodesic flow on surfaces. And then you also have what I mentioned before, using more geometrical property of measures, in the case of SRV measure, for instance, using Hopf argument. So our approach, as you guessed, is to use symbolic coding. So here is the proof. So you want to prove the uniqueness, so assume, so you fix a bound on the exponent chi, and you want to prove the uniqueness for equilibrium measures whose exponents are delta far from zero. If you do it for all chi, you're done. So since you have fixed chi, you can consider a coding. It's what we have said yesterday. So there exists a Markov shift that is an extension of the non-uniformly hyperbolic part of the class. There is a conjugacy between the shift and a set which contain all the chi hyperbolic measures homoclinically related to O. Two important properties. So the shift is irreducible, transitive. So then the entropy, when you lift a measure, the entropy remains the same, does not increase. That's because, if you remember, the preimage of a point is finite. And so with this property, if you lift an equilibrium state, it remains an equilibrium state. Because the entropy does not change, and you can lift the potential you had on the Homoclinic class to a function on the shift that you consider as a potential as well. The point is that if you had a Hölder continuous potential, since the semiconjugacy is Hölder, you also recover a Hölder potential on the shift. But there were also another case, a case of geometrical potential, which are only measurable. If you lift anyway, what you get is a Hölder continuous map. The reason is that the geometrical potential is defined by considering the unstable space, and the unstable space are only measurable, but vary, in fact, in a Hölder way, on arbitrarily onset with a compact subset with arbitrarily large measure for any measure. In fact, the splitting, the oscillated splitting in stable and unstable bundle, which is only measurable, you can lift it as a bundle over the symbolic setting system, and then you get a bundle which is Hölder. And yeah. Okay, so now being an equilibrium state on the class is the same as being an equilibrium state on the shift. And so you have reduced the problem to a problem on Markov shift. Okay, if you remember what we want to prove uniqueness. We want to check that the support is everything, and we want also to check that the measure is Bernoulli. So for Bernoulli, you also need to say that if you're Bernoulli above, then when you project, you're also Bernoulli. So now we are on Markov shift, and on Markov shift, we can apply this result due to Gurevich first, and then to Busy and Sarig in case of non-constant potential, which is exactly what we want. So Gurevich proved it in the case of potential zero. Let me just give an ID of the proof in this case. So to show that you have to study the measure maximizing the entropy, and what you want to show that it is a Bernoulli measure. So to show that it is a Bernoulli measure, what you do is take any measure and you can take its Markov approximation. So this is a measure. So you consider the zero cylinders. So they are the set of points which have a common symbol at zero. And you define a Bernoulli measure by saying that the measure of that rectangle is the same as the measure you started with. And also you define the measure on the one cylinder, so when you fix two letters, again, from the measure you get for your initial measure. So you have now Bernoulli measure, and you can show that its entropy is always larger or equal to the entropy of the initial measure. That's because when you compute the entropy of that measure, one way to compute the measurable entropy is to consider longer and longer cylinders and to consider the information associated to the cylinders, this quantity. So, and this information decreases, so almost immediately you get this inequality. So the maximizing measures are always Bernoulli. And then you can just play with the weights to show in which case you maximize. So the fact that you can approximate, how do you conclude that the maximum? This, no, because you, any measure, for any measure, you also need to prove the uniqueness, right? So this inequality is in fact strict. If you're not Bernoulli, because then you continue to compute the entropy, you will produce a longer cylinder. And if they don't satisfy the, coincide with the measure of cylinders given for the Bernoulli one, you will, the entropy decreases strictly by convex inequality. Okay? So this is about the uniqueness. And now let me go to the results about existence. So for existence, I mentioned the result of Newhouse. This is a direct generalization. So consider a map that has to be smooth, infinity, and a potential, we need that it is continuous. So for instance, it won't say anything for geometrical potential. Then there always exists an equilibrium state. The proof is very short once you know the Ohmdin theory I have mentioned on Tuesday. So let me remember what the Ohmdin theory says. If the map is CR, just to see better how things are, then when you consider a sequence of measures, the entropy in general is not continuous, not even semi-continuous. So if you take the Lim soup of the entropy, and you want to compare it to the entropy of the limit measure, you may, there may be a gap in the continuity, but this gap is bounded by a quantity that is a tail entropy that I have introduced, and I will recall after, here, H star F. And this tail entropy is always bounded again by log of the Lipschitz size of F divided by the smoothness R. So if you're C infinity, the tail entropy is zero, and you get semi-continuity for the entropy with respect to the measures. So to find an equilibrium state, now you just say, okay, I consider a sequence of measure which approach the pressure, so which for the supremum I want to attain. And then any measure at the limit has an entropy which is larger or equal to the entropy of all these measures. And since my potential is continuous, I also have convergence of the integral of the potential, and so at the limit, I have an equilibrium state. So it's very simple. So behind that is Yomdin's theory. So we have used it twice. Huh? We have used it here, and we have used it also before to prove the finiteness of the homoclinic classes with large entropy, if you remember. So it's an important tool for us, and now I want to spend the last part of the lecture to explain a bit Yomdin theory. Well, a big part of my course was on surface, so I will restrict to the case of surfaces, which is much simpler. In fact, the proof of Yomdin is an induction over the dimension. In the beginning on surface is much simpler. In fact, okay, I will explain this now. So the goal is really to check that inequality. Any question? So what does it mean, this inequality? What is a tail entropy? Yeah. So the entropy, as I said, is measuring the number of orbits in your system once you fix a scale. And when the scale decreases, maybe new complexity appears. So the tail entropy tells you how much complexity appears at a very small scale. So for that, you need to introduce dynamical balls. So here of length n and scale epsilon. So you look at points whose orbit during time n follow the orbit of x at scale epsilon. You may also consider the infinite ball, forward infinite ball. So you require the same, but for all forward iterates. And then the local contribution to entropy at scale epsilon is in the following way. You look to all the infinite dynamical ball at scale epsilon, and you compute how many orbits appear in this ball. So you can write it using topological entropy. So looking at smaller and smaller scale, once you have fixed here this epsilon, you take the supremum of all balls, and this is the tail entropy at scale epsilon. And then the tail entropy itself is the limit when epsilon goes to zero. You can do the same for measures. So if you have an invariant measure, you do the same, but you restrict point inside sets with a big set with large measures. So as I said, Yomdin theory bounds the tail entropy by the Lipschitz norm of F divided by the smoothness. So for a CRD diffeomorphism. I've stated this on surfaces. In a higher dimension, you need here appears the dimension of the manifold or something related to the dimension of the manifold. Okay, so what are the steps for proving this inequality? So the entropy, in some sense, is something topological. You just look at orbits. So the big idea, the first big idea is to link to something which is more geometrical. So here are the steps. The first step is to apply a variation, to use a variational principle which allows to replace the tail entropy by a tail entropy computed on measures. So it's enough now to bound the tail entropy with respect to a given measure. So that measure would have, imagine it has positive entropy, and so it's a hyperbolic measure. And then Newhouse, which was one of the big actors also in that theory, proved an inequality, which is a step where you link topological information or a measure with something more differentiable. So the idea is Here you don't need, so the idea is to use Piacentin theory. So when you're at a point X, you look to the dynamical ball at some small scale following the orbit of X, but then you say, okay, X has an unstable manifold, and I may restrict to point in a huge set with large measure, and which have good stable manifold. And so I can always project all points in a neighborhood, these points in a huge set, to points to the curve, to the unstable curve. And when I iterate forward, these points remain at a small distance because they are on a stable manifold. And so if these points here are in a dynamical ball, this point will also, and if they separate, this point will also. So computing the entropy for this set is the same as computing for its projection. And so that's, okay, so now we have, we want to see how points separate inside a curve, a particular curve. And so this may be bounded by measuring how the length of this curve increase when we iterate. So this is how the meaning of that quantity. We consider the supremum over the CR curves of the length of the iterate, of the growth of the length of the iterate. But what's important is that we are only interested by the part of the curve that cover this set. So by part of the curve that remain in the dynamical ball. This is a key point. And the last step is to bound this this quantity by what you want, so the Billipschitz norm of F over R. And this is Yomdin's bound. So I want to give some idea about this inequality. So here is a goal. We have a CR curve, gamma, on the surface. In fact, this is true in any dimension. What's important is that we have a curve. This is why we consider dynamics on surface, because in higher dimension, you may have some manifold with higher dimension. But for that part, the dimension of the manifold is not so important. And you want to bound the length of the iterator of the curve, but just the part that remain in a dynamical ball. How to bound this length? A way to bound the length of a curve is to cover the curve by curves of length one, or in fact by subcurves whose geometry is bounded. So for that, we consider reparametrizations of gamma. So the idea is you have the interval 0, 1, you break it into many small pieces, and for each of them, you consider a new parametrization in such a way that when you compose the reparametrization, but the curve that you want to consider, so this is the iterator of the initial curve, then what you find has C1 norm 1, so that the length is less than 1. But the good remark here, the key point in this approach, is not only to bound the C1 size, but the CR size, as you will see. Yeah, this is what I will discuss. I just want to say that if you cover this set by such parametrization, cover means that, then you just count how many pieces you have, and you have a good estimate on the length. Okay? And you want to do it for arbitrarily large iterate n, so you have to estimate ln, this number ln, how it grows when n grows. And so here is an inequality that has to be checked. The number is exponential in n, but the rate is the Lipschitz size of f to the 1 over r. So being smoother and for f and considering curves that are smooth enough, you decrease the rate here. And you, so this is exactly what this quantity gives when you take the log. Okay, so this is what we want to do. Is it fine? So here is a, so this is done by induction. Huh? So you imagine you have found this bound up to time n. The image of gamma has been, the image that you're interested in, so the part that is in the dynamical ball, has been covered by several curves. You take one of them, you iterate again, so it grows, and you want to decompose it like here and to measure how many new pieces you needed for that. So what you see on the picture is that, so you consider a curve, so here this is a ball of radius epsilon. So since we follow a dynamical ball, we are only considering a curve that intersects that ball. And in fact, I didn't say here, all the species also have to stay inside a ball of radius 2 epsilon. Then you iterate, it grows. Maybe some part escape from the ball of radius 2 epsilon. So this, for sure, you have to split. And inside, you may say, okay, I just consider now all what I have inside, but I want to bound the geometry. So for bounding the geometry, I need to reparameterize and to split again. And so maybe here I have two parts or maybe more. This is what we have to understand now, okay? So I will try to explain. So here is how it is done. So the first thing is that if you look to the CR norm of a diffeomorphism, it coincides with the you may assume it's coincide with its Lipschitz size. For that, to reduce to that, you just need to rescale the diffeomorphism. Because if you look at, if you rescale a diffeomorphism, so you conjugate by a homotacy, the C1 size does not change, whereas the other norm, the norm of the higher derivative, if you zoom, they decrease. You may assume that. This is our assumption. And this is why everything here only works when epsilon is small enough. You have zoom. What's important in that estimate is that this estimate is uniform in the diffeomorphism. I mean, depends on just on explicitly on the diffeomorphism, but provided epsilon is small enough. Okay, so you iterate f satisfying this equality, and you start with a curve. You have your induction assumption, which is that the curve you consider has CR size less or equal to 1. You iterate, so you look to f just once, you look to f composed with gamma. Now the CR size is not, it may be larger, so you need to reparameterize. It's done in several times. So the first thing you do is that you will split the interval into many pieces whose size is like the Lipschitz norm of f to minus 1 over r. So the idea here, so you decompose into 1 over l pieces, and it's as what I said here, you conjugate by an homotacy with a very small factor. And so when you do that, the higher derivative decrease. They decrease faster when the derivative is higher. Here your CR. So you do just what you need so that the CR derivative is less or equal to 1. Doing that, you don't realize that for the image, the CR size is not less or equal to one. It's just bounded for the CR derivative, but the derivative with smaller order may be too large to satisfy the condition we want. But doing that, we have split into that number of pieces, which correspond to the number we are allowed to do. If we compose with a stronger homotacy, you would also bound in a better way the smaller derivative, but you would have more pieces. This is not what you want. Okay. So now you consider each of these pieces and you just have bound the CR derivative. And you say, okay, I have a piece now with CR bounded derivative. What about the other derivative? Well, in fact, if for some reason the piece you consider, in fact, is contained in the ball of radius one or epsilon, then you may use interpolation inequality to say that all the derivative in between are also bounded by one or by a constant, and you're done. So the question is, for the pieces you consider, how to restrict to a ball of size one or epsilon. So I just want to intersect my curve again with that ball, and when I intersect, I cut into more pieces. But maybe doing that, I will increase too much the number of pieces. So this is what we have to estimate. And for that, this is what is called the algebraic lemma, which is something quite elementary in dimension one, but much more complicated in higher dimension. It uses semi-algebraic tools. So the idea is you have a curve with CR bounded size, but maybe the curve is long. Some parts go far away from the ball and you're only interested by what happened in the ball. You can replace the map, the curve, by a polynomial one, because you just take the Taylor expansion and replace the curve by its Taylor expansion. Using this inequality, you can estimate the mistake you do and show that you don't affect too much what you want to do. So you may assume that your curve is polynomial, whose degree is R. And when you have a polynomial curve with degree R, if you look to the intersection with the ball, so you want to see at which time you cross the boundary of the ball. Well, you're trying to find the roots for a polynomial with given degree, and so you see that you cross the boundary just for bounded, universally bounded number of points, which is 2R, basically. So you can split more, now that you have a polynomial curve, you can split more, decompose into a bounded number of pieces that sits inside this ball. And then you apply the interpolation inequality to bound all the other derivatives. And if you'll see how many pieces you needed, in the first step you needed that number of pieces, which is large, but then in the other step you just need a bounded more number of pieces. So at last, at each step, you increase with that rate. Okay? So this was to give an idea about Yomdin techniques in dimension one. And so this finishes basically what I wanted to say in that mini course. So what's next? So we are still working with this kind of system with Jérôme Buzy and Omri Sarig, and we have so the next natural goal would be to understand better the stochastic properties of these measures, and so we hope that we are able soon to prove that. If you look on surface to the measure maximizing the entropy, then you should satisfy central limit theorem and also have exponential mixing. Yeah. Okay, so I will stop here. Thank you for your attention.
Any questions or comments? If not, let's thank that the speaker again. So now we have a tea break and we come back at 10:45.